So this was the first thing that we undertook in our IoT project, which consisted of two items. Firstly, we needed a reliable analog non-IoT mechanism of creating our coffee, just in case. So we found a large cold brew tower in Australia that takes 8 hours to brew coffee, and it's very, very strong. And then we found a bag of the world's most caffeinated coffee, and we combined the two together into what we dubbed Fuckoffee. And I can tell you that for the first 40 minutes of reverse engineering, your productivity is through the roof. The rest of it, really, all of the day, is in the toilet. Regardless, this is what most of our days look like after a few doses of the aforementioned. Plugging in weird little boxes and cameras, little kind of intercepts and taps, kind of you name it, with a variety of systems. So I want to show you a little run-through of one of these products. And I've got a video of it, which is basically in real time, so you can see me being moronic at various stages. I was going to cut it out, but frankly, it's quite entertaining stuff there. I've chosen it because it's far from the worst product. It would be easy to go to the extremes. And it's not kind of the shining golden example that we would hope for. It's a perfect representation of the average level of being really bad at security that we found in lots of these IoT products. So when we started unpicking this particular camera, one of the first things you want to do is to get your hands on a copy of the firmware. You want to be able to pull out files and binaries and have a little look on the inside and understand the security implementation. In some of these devices, it's really tough. In this particular device, really not that difficult. I actually took the firmware version off the box, and then I went and Googled for the firmware. I just put in the name of it. After searching down the page a little bit, I found this really handy firmware.txt that contains a list of all the firmware versions and hashes with MD5s. I tried to access the directory to see if I could grab the firmware version I wanted, but you know, security, no directory listing. So I took one of the file names and just changed the version number to the one that it claimed was on my camera, which very happily downloaded. So job one, copy of firmware secure. Now, let me show you what this looks like in a mix of live assessment and static analysis. There's a lot more we can do here. I'll dive off in a little bit into IDA and show you some of the harder approach. But I think you'll be as astonished as I was at some of the types of flaws we see here. So first things first, just configuring networking. The camera's connected in a nice Class C. I've got a couple of different models here. And I'm going to start by just doing an nmap scan of it. Right? So not rocket science. We're looking for open ports. You can see from the speed of that there's no firewalling or anything like that. There's no stealthing. It just honestly replies to which ports are exposed. For those of you that may not be able to see that clearly, allow me to just zoom in on this monstrosity of horror here. Where is it gone? This little, just this. Yes. So, pro tip, no. Never okay. In 2017, this firmware was last updated at the end of 2016, by the way, so it is actually pretty recent. This is a bad idea. I mean, if you want to purposely suck, at least do SSH version 1. Suck a little bit. Like, not quite that much. Backwards compatibility nightmare. You have to download a client for Windows now. It's annoying. So it is actually Telnet. And we do ultimately want to break into that. Interesting fact for you at this point. This particular camera was claimed to be one impacted by Mirai. Right, that piece of malware that romped around the world getting CCTV cameras and DVRs and briefly took DYN, Twitter and others offline. Now, this camera wasn't actually impacted because the username and password that was published in the source code that people thought impacted this camera was only useful for the web interface. We'll see in about 10 minutes how it's trivial to get Mirai running on this thing and increase the scale of that attack by a very significant amount. You see this port here, 81. You see what they've done here it recognizes it as this host2-ns. It is just a standard HTTP web server. What they've done, which is pretty clever, I think you'll agree, is they've moved the port number up by one. No way any of you guys are going to find that. And it definitely doesn't UPnP negotiate to the internet so everyone can find it. Nope. All right, so we'll connect to it in a web browser. Oh, there's a lot in this video, there's a lot of me randomly highlighting stuff. That's what I do when I'm thinking and trying to decide what to do next. So we'll just log in here, admin, and the password is 68. Because, you know, you'd think it would be 8. This particular device, there's three ways to find the password that I immediately know of. The first one is you can look on the bottom of the box, and it's the same for every device. I had thrown the box away, which is slightly unfortunate. So I went onto Amazon, and if you click through the product images, you can actually find a preview of the box where you can see the password in the image in the shopping cart. So you don't even have to buy it. It's great. The other option, it has no throttling of attempts or guesses. So you can just keep guessing. Remember those days with computers and phones before they would lock? Do you ever do that thing where your coworker goes to the bathroom and you just keep guessing on their phone until it says locked for an hour? Are you that person? I'm that person. And then you come across the one person who set their phone to entirely delete after 10 attempts, and then you realise, you know, you are that person. And you don't do it anymore, you stop. But this, you can just keep guessing. I love their authentication zone called Go Ahead. It's like, come at me, bro. So, all right, let's get logged in here. Clearly, their web design team are stuck in 1994 with HTML4. If we actually log into the product in question, this particular firmware is used on a lot of camera models. It's white labeled no end in many places. It's under my desk. It's great. We'll go to the settings section, and you can see the firmware version and the web UI version. So that's kind of handy, right? We're logged into the web user interface. We're doing a bit of a live assessment. I've got a copy of this set of firmware files downloaded from that previous video that I showed you. The goal here is to be able to find some kind of mechanism, some vulnerability that enables us to persistently gain access to the device, ideally with a shell, because then we can do a shell happy dance, and that's good, or to connect to these devices and be able to execute commands, some kind of RCE, over the web UI. Thankfully, both of those things are true in 14 different ways. I'm going to show you two. So let's go to our firmware here. We're going to use binwalk to extract the firmware, the wonderful binwalk. It pulls everything out. You do have to install a couple of odd little patches to make it work nicely. There's two firmware files, one which contains web files, it appears to be web UI of the admin interface, and one that contains the actual binaries running on the device. Note, in this first one here, we have the web files. There's a directory with a bunch of empty files with file names that look really interesting, but they're empty. Then there is a zip file, which, interestingly enough, when you try and extract it, if you can type, is bloopers reel, is password protected and is showing the path www. So this company distributes their updates to the web UI using password protected zip files. Sure, why not? So obviously I tried the password because it's illegal not to. That didn't work. Rather than going and trying to brute force it, we had just finished building a new 10 GPU NVIDIA GTX 1080i machine, 4800 watts. I turn it on and I can feel the money running out of my pocket. It's delightful. I didn't want to use that because it's just so expensive, albeit, you know, very pretty and good for Ethereum mining. So we jump over to the other firmware file here. Oh, come on, it's not that hard. There we go, tab autocomplete. Right, so lots of different model numbers, but there's this system one that's there by default, and if we just traverse through it, there's some binaries. some stuff that runs on the camera. Kind of makes sense. Update a Wi-Fi daemon encoder, you know, grade.sh. Interesting stuff for us to have a play with. So we'll have a look at grade.sh first, and we can see some things about how it mounts the file system. We can see that the version of the kernel that it's using, U-boot. It is running a 2.6 kernel, which is, well, impressively old, really. They I think, have purposely degraded to a much older kernel because it's much more lightweight, and it means cheaper hardware on which they can run this stuff. But it also means all of those wonderful mitigations we have in the modern world, address space layout, randomization, stuff like that. No, none of that, right? It's really akin to a Windows XP security model. XPSP0, not SPSP2. It doesn't have any data execution prevention. In other words, it's really shit. So, can I say that? Yeah, okay, good, I'm just checking. That's too late otherwise. So we can see here it's ARM, which, I'm okay with reversing. MIPS is more annoying, but I just opened up a GDB and having a look at some of the functions on the inside. We're not going to do any clever reverse engineering here for now, but just interested to see what they've exposed. What's really immediately interesting to me is they don't strip their binaries. For those of you who are thinking that's a strange kind of come on line in the bar, well, that would be weird. When you produce a binary, you compile from source code, you typically run it through a process of stripping and removing symbols. You don't want to leave these nice, clean names of functions in there, because it makes it trivial for a reverse engineer to go, ooh, that bit looks interesting. One of my favorite functions in this particular binary, you may not be able to immediately guess what it does, is called create telnet password. I wonder. Yes, we'll have a look at that shortly. It's great fun to reverse engineer. So this is a sign of immaturity compared to the traditional software world. You know, we beat up Microsoft sometimes. We get upset with them. But whilst years ago I'd lambast them for making horrible mistakes, they do some damn great work in security process mitigations and controls these days. So before we go reversing, let's go even more budget on the situation. We're going to use strings on Wi-Fi daemon. We'll pull out consecutive ASCII values and look for words. And obviously the right thing to do here is to search for password, because that would be interesting. So /pass. Oh look, that's really cool. Right. So, anyone, what does that do? What's that for?
It contains user IDs and passwords.
Right. It contains user IDs for the systems and their respective user ID numbers, GECOS information, and so on. On more modern Linux systems, it is conventional that you have etsy password and etsy shadow. Etsy shadow contains the password hashes, the secured stored version of the password. Etsy password has the user IDs. On older Linux distributions, they are all in one file. Which is exactly the case here, that the gentleman is exactly right. So we've got the username, and the fact he's an administrator, of the device. This is helpful, because this wasn't published anywhere. So we've got a username. What's this percent %s? Anyone know? Yes, put a string value here. It's a format string specifier. So that means do some stuff, come up with a value, put it here. So that's where the password would normally go. So look, I'm reassured they're not just statically putting the same password in every time. Maybe. Let's take this a little bit further. By the way, at this rate, I'm going to do mostly IoT and like the tiniest bit of ransomware, but are we all having fun? Okay, good, all right. I like this bit more too. Apparently I've got way too much content. I'm not really sure what I was thinking. But, standard protocol, isn't it? I usually do that, I'm sorry. Okay, so let's search for the beginning of this username to see if there's any references to it. Do a little search through the strings again in this same binary. Note that at least malware authors tend to use obfuscation or XOR private values. These are literally plain text. And when your software security is lesser than a malware author, that's really quite embarrassing. Come on. Yes. No. Close. Keep going. There it is. Right. There's an unzip command followed by dash capital P. Would anyone like to guess what the dash capital P might be? Yes, this is where I spat some of my fuck offy across the room and had to have a brief break to kind of tidy up the mess that I had created. Yeah, so this is a password for something called www.zip. Ah, yes, that's really handy. So let's double back to the previous little directory that we, the previous web firmware directory that we had. Take a copy of that value. Got it. It's really weird watching yourself type commands and quite infuriating. There we go. Good. Right. Now, I should mention, in every version I've looked at, the password is always exactly the same. So this is fun because you can now deliver a zip file by mitteming the software update with the correct password and it will overwrite it. It was at this point we bricked one of the cameras by replacing every page with a picture of Goku saying Kamehameha. which was great, other than the fact that we destroyed it and we needed a new one. One of the guys that works for me, Hashem, did the same thing to a DVR, and you turn the DVR on and it just immediately goes Kamehameha and stops. It's like a 300 euro output of a single image. I think it's great. So here we have an FTP file. There are loads of files in here. I started picking on this one because it's got lots and lots of user inputs. And we like user inputs because they're opportunities to make a litany of errors. Things like buffer overflows in failing to process lengths, failing to deal with tokens correctly, command injection, maybe SQL injection, who knows? Now, as we go through this code apace, and there is a version of this video up online. Wow. Are you okay? It is very exciting, isn't it? It's like, look at that code, it's horrible! Sparta! Sorry. So, as you go through all this code, something interesting is apparent. There's no programmatic code in here, it's just UI that appears to take these various values and stuff them into some program. They haven't used kind of a nice modern web language. They appear to be using just front-end HTML and JavaScript and plugging it into a binary on the back end, so a kind of zero-tier business architecture. That binary, by the way, does happen to run as root, as we'll find out later. Always make your web server run as root. It's awesomer. okay, here we go. Come on. I'm going to just skip forward a little bit for the sake of brevity. Here we go. So I'm going back to system, and I'm going to the bin directory. My goal here was to look for references to web-related functions, port 81, gets, posts, etc., to get a quick sense of what was processing this set of functions. I also cheated and jumped over to IDA, but I'm going to save that for a little later towards the end here. So I wanted to search through every file for the value 81, so I wrote this needlessly flamboyant, over-the-top, complicated command, but looks awesome. And then I ran the same command because I was a little brain dead and I added the wrong letter, but it output loads of cool stuff and I didn't want to admit it was wrong, so I scrolled through it a bit to make it look like I meant to do it. Wow. It's like, you know, when people open an XCube with notepad, they're like, yep, good, close. That particular binary does have some web-related functions. The other one does as well. Interestingly, this particular camera has get requests related to DYN DNS. It also, for some reason, connects to a porn site. I have no idea why, and no, I'm not telling you which one because we'll go to it. So let's have a play with this here. I can tell you now that there is no filtering whatsoever on this, and the way it handles its web requests is executing them to a binary via the command line. which is code for literally the most insane way you could do anything ever in the history of all time. Of course, by this period of time, I've had so much coffee I could see through time. So I've set up a very simple FTP server. A lie. I was going to make an FTP server. Has anyone here ever tried to configure VS FTPD? Oh God, should we hug? Like it hurts, doesn't it? I mean, once it's working, it's great, but setting it up is really painful. So I made a netcat lister on port 21 as my FTP server. I thought that would do the job. Configured my FTP server to my attacker's IP and set the username field to $, open bracket, no, open bracket, cat, slash, etsy, slash, pass7d, close bracket. In other words, please just go and get the contents of the etsy password file and put it here. Yes, exactly. That. You don't know whether to be horrified or amused, you're like, no. That's the kind of thing that I would have expected when I was like 13. But in the world of modern computers, this is not really how hacking tends to go. And this is surprisingly common. This is not a one-off in IoT world. So let's submit it. I hit test. The idea of this feature is it connects and uploads a kind of mini video of any intruders or alike that have been in the vicinity. So I hit enter, and here we go. You can see it sends me the username and the hashed password here. Yeah? So we've got a web attack that enables us to do command injection, that enables us to grab a password hash and exfiltrate it via FTP. Awesome. Of course, we could have used that same flaw to upload a shell or add a user, but you know, this is just cooler. So we're gonna carry on with this. Does anyone notice anything interesting about this? Yes, go on, sir. You're close. You're really close. In the sense that it is crappy. You are on the money. Yeah, that's the right line of thinking. It's a crypt. It uses DES. You remember DES? No, because most of you aren't old enough for it to have been a good idea. This is old stuff. In fact, when we go look at it, they purposely recompiled the kernel to re-enable this shitty option. They worked hard to be this bad, which is kind of impressive, I suppose. So it's DES. Now, obviously, it doesn't take too long to go and crack this. So let's grab a copy of this hash. In reality land, we'd fire up our cracking rig. But seeing as it was DES, I was like, you know, I'm going to run it in a virtual machine on a MacBook Pro and see what happens. Give it a little go. So I put the hash in. I used the standard little word list, the default one. And off it goes, crypt and DES. So, first thing to notice, see this here? Max length. 13 is too large for the current hash type, reduced to 8. Remember that bit, okay? So it goes off cracking, and it takes about 5 minutes to exhaustively get to the answer here. So we'll skip forward a little bit. There we go. Okay. So this is Le Mot de Passe. 2015-06-02. All numbers. Great. Love that. Interesting fact. If you go and look at the code in IDRA, I'll show you if I don't horribly run out of time, which is kind of going that way because I'm having too much fun and rambling. They actually have code to add a random value to the end of this password. So they've got a base word of 2015-06-02, followed by a random value for the device, which forms the result. 2015-06-02. Shit. Are you with me? They've randomized the password and then cut off all of the stuff that was random. So on every device, it is exactly the same password. Great job. So just to prove this one out here, we'll take a copy of that password. And here is the create telnet password function that I mentioned before. And There is actually a buffer overflow in it as well, which is delightful. And if we just now go and telnet in, copy the username and password. Come on. This is because I can't type. Hard bit done, can't type credential. Yes, copy. No, that's the username, don't do that. There we go, got there in the end. We get logged in, and we do our ID command, and we can see that immediately we're running as root. It transpires there is only one user on the system, which is the root user, this particular account. You can see everything running, you can look at that one user, you can see all the IDs and passwords. You can see some of their setup scripts. There is a declared shadow file, but the file doesn't exist. Guess they didn't want that. And we can also, really good fun, if we go and look in their vendor folder, we can actually see the PSK for their engineering test network that they've commented out in one of the files, because that's always a great idea. Oh, fix the key that's used to log in and register the camera, so you can go see where all the other cameras are worldwide. So much easier than scanning. default PSK, new PSK, etc., etc. So it's not really, you know, great, is it? This is a remarkably common and typical IoT device. These rudimentary failures of security, like using kind of really ancient versions of hashing standards, is sadly remarkably common. So, look, how long do I got? How long have I got?
Oh, you've got about 7 minutes.
7 minutes?
Yes.
That's like quite a lot of time, actually. That's better than I thought. Before I wrap up then, let me give you a whirlwind tour of this ransomware stuff I want to just quickly show you, because it's quite good fun. I do have a recording of this ransomware stuff in full, done with greater justice, which I'll share. But this is quite good. This is one of my favorite pieces of ransomware of all time. I love this piece of ransomware. I'm going to just open up this ransomware with a tool called ILVASM. This lets us just inspect the inside of one of these samples. Here we go. Loads of errors because it's got obfuscation in it. All right, I'm going to zoom in on the bits that are kind of interesting here. This piece of ransomware is one of the more shocking ones. It started early in 2016. It's topical at the moment because this particular gang has been selling their services online. Lots of derivatives have appeared recently, and they just started pretending to be WannaCry. So they've changed the extension and the messaging to look like WannaCry and ride off the PR value. This ransomware has been reasonably successful, but it's absolutely terrible. For one, when we actually open up the binary, it's generally speaking a really bad idea if you build malware to have something called .hacking and .locker in the binary. If we look over that in hacking here, ooh, lots of exciting fun stuff, XE smart copy and random nonsense. Let's have a look in locker. Oh, encryption password, that sounds helpful. Yes, so there's the encryption password that all your files will be encrypted with. Some very complex reverse engineering required on this one. But they do follow some wonderful advice. You know, don't roll your own crypto. They do just call the Windows API to do encryption for them. Now, let me just run this piece of malware in this VM quickly. I'll let it run away in the background. You may spot when it actually gets to a point of infection. It can, on occasion, be a little subtle. But if we look at the properties of this particular piece of malware whilst it's encrypting all my data, you'll note it says it's Firefox, product name Firefox, product version, copyright. For those of you at the back, the original file name is included in the metadata, and the original file name is bitcoinblackmailer.exe. Great. Great. So the obvious thing to do at this point for me here is to just go and do a little perusal of the darknet/dark web/ the internet. And I just went and searched for the password that we just found, right? It transpires that cybercriminals do not RTFM. This is the documentation for the cybercriminal author of this ransomware as a service campaign. I found it because it contains the literal default password string. The majority of ransomware samples out there built from this use the defaults. Firefox is included here. So I clicked paranoid mode, obviously immediately, because who doesn't want to click paranoid mode? And you can see some of the features here are pretty interesting. You can customize the amount that you ransom. So how much should you ask for ransom? Well, I don't know. If you have a specific target, adjust this amount to the target's financial liquidity. Ooh. If you spread it ever on the internet, I would keep it low. My feeling, $20 to $50 would be optimal, but honestly, I have no idea. Oh, always good to get sales tactics from your cyber criminal. If we skip to this one, there's some more sinisterness here. There's the version masquerading. From here, this looks like a series of small, tiny pixels. I don't know if you can see that better. Maybe it's just because I'm close. But I have a video of it, so you can have a look at it more closely. This bit I love. What it does, it activates your malware only after a specific date. Why is this important? Imagine a scenario where you spread your software in a forum, you put it in, someone downloads it and says, don't download virus. Why not activate it in 10 days or even 2 months? Then a lot of people will think, nah, this software doesn't work. That is a different, way more harmless reaction. I mean, you say harmless, but they are ultimately talking about ransomware in more people's computers, of course. So let's have a look at the actual ransomware. There we go. It's beautiful, isn't it? Yeah? What I love about this particular piece of ransomware is they've got quite a nice user experience. They randomly delete the file every so often. It's one of the more kind of English-friendly versions. This is great, though. They've got this button you can press to say, I made a payment, give me back my files. How does that work? Well, obviously, they've done certificate pinning and put SSL in place. And so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put a proxy on over here, and I'm going to click the button, and we're going to go and wait for it to connect to a site of interest. So it's connecting to btc.blocker.io. It's a Bitcoin status and wallet site. So let's forward a few of these requests. I'm nearly done, I'm sorry.
You're good.
I went from being early to just, you know, overrunning horribly. It's kind of my thing. All right, here we go. So now, just here, we have a query of a wallet address that is included in the malware, and it's doing a balance check. So these cyber criminals have gone, what would be great is if we didn't have to do any support, if you could just check with the Bitcoin site and see if they've paid us money, that would be awesome. Well, of course, all the principles we tell legitimate software companies come to bear here. Let's have a look at the reply. There it is. That was painful. Okay. So look, we've got a Bitcoin wallet and a balance. I wonder what would happen if you just maybe change that to many, many bitcoins. Forward. Oh, thank you for paying. Decrypting your files, it will take a while. After I've done it, I'll close completely and remove myself from your computer. And to be honest, their uninstallation routine is better than the majority of actual software products. It's very, very tidy. So, look, aside from wanting to close my presentation here with poking some fun at some ransomware authors, there's an interesting couple of messages to take from this. The first is, a lot of ransomware is successful despite itself. There's a lot of really, really awful ransomware out there that has terrible design practices, that, you know, really doesn't have any security, where it's trivial to write tools to strip this stuff off. But an ecosystem is developing where we've got a small number of people selling toolkits. We've seen progressive small improvements in the quality of implementation. I recently saw a malware campaign that had terrible crypto, but everything else about it was perfect, the payment channels and so on. Be stolen by a cyber criminal gang. They hollowed out all of the crypto code, replacing it with an appropriate use of the ChemDem crypto model, producing a piece of ransomware where we don't have the ability to write a tool to get the data back. They're learning lessons, they're improving their quality. If they're seeing this scale of success with what they're producing today, what happens when they start to optimize? On IoT, my closing sentiment really is this. It is as bad as you see in the news. That's specifically why. It's a big, huge discussion where we could talk about what to do about that. But one thing to really reflect on. At the moment, these devices are still toys, right? They're Wi-Fi dongles, Wi-Fi power plugs, you know, lights, kind of kids' toys. They're toys. We can unplug them if they do bad things and don't work. How long will it be till there's a Pokemon Go moment and there's some IoT device with actual PII or a light everywhere? How long will it be till those capabilities are in every moment of our physical lives, at home, at work? They're in the fabric of the things that we depend on. And this entire industry is using a set of security practices that would have been embarrassing to Microsoft 10 years ago, if not more. Wouldn't we rather find ways to fix those things whilst they're toys, rather than going through the crucible of pain we did in the days of Windows 95 and Windows 98, if you remember it? And if not, man, you weren't there. Thank you very much for listening to me, Ran. I hope you enjoyed that. I'll catch you all later.